at Ypsilanti, Michigan, and I had some students in my class who really didn't like to read that much. And it wasn't that they couldn't read, they were more into, I'd rather be doing something else. So after lunch, every day, we'd have deer. You all know what deer is, drop everything and read for them. They weren't going for it. It was tough for them, they just couldn't sit still. Some of the fellas had to go to the bathroom for about a half an hour every single day.
That sounds familiar.
Okay, you sure? Or they would sit next to each other and play and try to get kicked out and sent to the office, but I didn't do that. So one day in November, I decided I'm going to write a book. And I was late one night. I probably should have been asleep. Instead, I was awake, and I said, I'm going to write a book. I hadn't written a book before. I had done some poems, some songs, plays, stuff like that for my students, but nothing as official as a book like that. And I went to school the next day, and they had the morning, and then after lunch we had our deer session again. And so the fellows were lined up to have to use the bathroom, and the ladies were or whatever. And I said, we're not doing deer today. And there was a celebration. Every fellow in line walked back to their seat, sat down, no one had to use the bathroom anymore. And I said, I am going to write a book. And they looked at me like, are you out of your mind? You're going to write a book. And I said, yes, I am going to write a book. And while I'm writing this book in the classroom, you all have to read for the entire hour. No interruptions, no bathroom breaks, no nudging your partner, none of that stuff. You have to read. And they said, okay. And I went and sat down like, I'm a boss. I tell kids what to do. They listen. And there's one girl, her name was Kiana Hughes. Her little hand goes up. And she goes, Mr. Parks. She was a little sassy, but really smart. I said, yes. And she said, we have some stipulations as well. Stipulations? You're going to tell me what to do? I'm the teacher. I'm telling y'all what to do. This is my classroom. This is my kingdom. You follow my directions. And she said, no, we're serious. We have stipulations, too. It has to be funny. It needs to be at least 100 pages. And we have to be able to give you constructive criticism. Now, if you don't know what constructive criticism is, that means they can tell me what's wrong with it, what they don't like about it, in hopes of me making the book better. Teachers do that for you all, but most of the time, us as teachers, we don't have people give us very much constructive criticism unless it's our boss, or maybe a parent who doesn't like our teaching style. So most of the time, we're expected to be the professionals and know everything and do everything okay. Take it from one teacher, probably speaking for all of us, we make mistakes too. So that day, I started writing. And I could only write in the classroom, either at my desk or right next to a kid. I couldn't write at home. I couldn't write at the coffee shop. I couldn't write while I was driving. You paying attention? It was a joke. Around here. Okay. Get back to just the story. No jokes. No more. I promise. I'm sorry. So I would write with them every day, just about. At least three times a week, I would read to them, and they enjoyed it. And then in April, I had what writers call writer's block. Now, if you've ever had writer's block before, it's tough. I couldn't think of it. To do, to write more in the book, to finish it. And my students were upset with me at that time. They had been reading, they had been writing in their own journals, the water bill in the school had went down because the fellows weren't in the bathroom for so long. Everyone in the area was happy until I couldn't write anymore. And they were like, suck it up, Mr. Parks. I mean, you tell us to keep going. How come you have to stop? That's not fair. And I'm like, did I say all that stuff to y'all? I didn't say the first one. But anyway, 6 weeks went by, and we're getting toward the end of the school year. By this time, parents are now asking, well, what's going on with the book? When are you going to finish it? Like, you're not in my classroom. Why are you asking me questions about the book? What goes on in my classroom stays in my classroom. You all should know about this. I guess the students have been going home and talking to their parents about it during dinner time or on the way home from school, et cetera, et cetera. So then there was a bunch of pressure on me to finish this book because I didn't want to let the kids in. I mean, I don't like them. That's just how I think. And so, bless you.
Bless you. Bless you.
Oh, another one coming, or you good?
I'll hold it down.
Okay. Appreciate it. But if you need it, you let it out. I don't want to hurt yourself. No animals. So, 2 days before school ended, I was able to finish the book. And it wasn't 100 pages, it was 91 pages. it was 91 of the best pages that I could come up with, and I finished it, and they liked it. The following year, in August, I put it in a contest. It was the Michigan Elementary Middle School Principals Association conference, or no, authors contest, okay? And so they have this every year, and authors who either write about Michigan or from the state of Michigan enter this contest, and you have to pay like $40, and they turn your books in, and hopefully if you win, your book gets published by this Mackinac Island Press group. And so I turned it in after working on it a lot. A friend of mine and I went to the coffee shop every Friday night. I could have been hanging out, watching TV. I'm at the coffee shop revising on my book every Friday night, trying to make it better, trying to make sure the color of Lenny's socks don't change from red, white, and blue to black, back to red, white, and blue. So all those little things that I missed when I first wrote the book, she went through and helped me to fix them. So I enter this contest thinking, maybe I'll do it. Then I get an email that says, you're in the top 25. I'm excited, I'm doing my little dances, I'm telling the students in my class, because I taught a fourth and fifth grade class where some of the fourth graders from the previous year are now in fifth grade. So they knew about the entire process of me writing the book. And they're all excited, like, all right, you're in the top 25, you can do this. So then I stopped getting emails from them, but there was a lady who was in the building with me who also would get the emails from the people. And so this Friday, I was leaving school to go home, and she told me, she called, she said, you're in the top 10. I didn't get an email. Oh, well, it's okay. I'll let you know from now on if you're, you know, moving on. And so I celebrated all weekend. I went and did some more editing. And then 2 weeks later, I found out I was in the top 4. Did they send me an email? No. They sent the lady the email, and the lady tells me. And I'm excited. This point in time, I'm nervous because I could win this thing. I mean, I have a 1 out of 4 chance, 25%. I wrote my acceptance speech. I was ready to go because I'm figuring positive thinking, I can do this. Now, at work, I was nervous. The kids were like, because I'm always like calm, laid back. I crack jokes. I talk like this. And then we just have a good time. The learning is just, it's just relaxed. And it's almost like we're watching TV or something like that. The kids talk more. Me most of the time. So they're like, Mr. Parks, what's wrong with you? You look nervous, you're scared or something? And I start to tell them, yeah, I could win this contest, but then I could lose this contest. So one of the girls, Kiana Hughes, again, says, Mr. Parks, you know what? You should take a bath. Do you have a jacuzzi? And I said, as a matter of fact, I have a bath with the jets and all that stuff. She says, get in one of those and get you some candles, aromatherapy. So that's supposed to keep me all calm and relaxed, and so I'm not worrying about this. So then one of my fellas, he says, yeah, Mr. Parks, and you should listen to some jazz, too. My uncle listens to jazz, and that calms him. So do I look like the bath type to actually jump in the bath and relax and, you know, exfoliate or whatever it is? I did it. It didn't work for me. I was still real nervous. One day, I had the afternoon off, and so I was in Ann Arbor buying T-shirts for book, and I ended up calling to find out if I won because they said the announcement is imminent and it will be out soon, and so stay tuned. And so I got tired of waiting and I called. The secretary there said, if you haven't heard from our lawyer yet, you didn't win. And I'll never forget where I was. I was on the corner of Main Street and Liberty in Ann Arbor, and I realized then that I didn't win the contest. And instead of throwing my phone down or being upset or yelling at somebody, I said, well, can I still come to the banquet that you all are having? She said, you want to go? And I said, yeah, I'll go, no problem. And so she said, what's your credit card number? Because they were having this fancy chicken and she wanted me to pay for it right away. So I paid and I went up and I figured, I know me. If I go into a room, I can win the room. Here's what I'll do. I'm gonna walk up to the publisher. I'm gonna say, I don't even need the seal of approval. We can do business together. So I did like this when I met him. I said, hey, how are you? I'm Marquin Parks. Nice to meet you. How are things? You've heard of my book, Wrinkles Wallace. And I tried to do this, but in actuality, he was like, see you later, dude. And I was stuck. I was standing there. I didn't win. I'd driven all the way up there, but I met some nice people while I was up there. And they actually put me in a place for a job And so for writing this book and chasing my dreams and going and meeting the right people, I ended up getting a job in a different district that paid me $12,000 more. Now, the book didn't win the contest, and I actually met the guy who won the contest, and he's a really nice guy. His book was really good, and they had big plans for what they were going to do with it. So I didn't stop there. For most people, okay, I didn't win this contest. That means I'm finished. My dreams of getting my book published is over. Instead, I kept writing, and I wrote the fifth book, and then I wrote the second book, and I wrote the third book, and then I wrote the fourth book. And then I submitted the first book to a publisher. I never heard back from them. They're still trying to tell me no or yes or something. Then I submitted it to another publisher. And they liked the first book. They liked the first book a lot. But they weren't calling me like I wanted them to call me. They weren't giving me that attention that said, we're going to move forward and get this book published. So I sent them the fifth book that I had written. No one, you know, knew what I was doing. I figured keep writing. And they liked it. They liked it so much so that they said, we need to have dinner this week. And I said, dinner? And I said, yes, dinner. Where would you like to go? So in Ann Arbor, there's this place called the Quarter Bistro. And I really liked the steak there. And so I said, let's go there. So I went, and I ordered the biggest steak on the menu. They were paying for it, of course. I had mashed potatoes. They were creamy with the butter and a little bit of gravy on them, and mixed vegetables. I'm not a vegetable guy, or I wasn't back then. I like them now. But the vegetables were even delicious. And we talked about the books. What I wanted to do and how I wanted to work, and then it came up. So this book has put me on television. I've been on the morning news in Saginaw, been on the cover of the Oakland Press. It's taken me all around Michigan. The book is down in the Dominican Republic. It's in Jamaica. It's in Denmark. It's in Canada. It's all around the United States. And it's just given me opportunities to meet and talk to great kids like yourself. That's the story of how the book came to be. It was me not necessarily thinking that it was going to be a physical book. It was just something that I wanted to do to encourage my students to be better readers. And it has changed my life. Me sticking with it, me doing more writing, me being able to take critiques from people who don't like what I do, me not winning that contest was a great thing for me because it made me work even harder. I sat on a panel right next to the guy who won the contest. And if you had to ask who won and who lost, you would probably think I won because I made sure that I did everything I could to be successful. I didn't stop because they said I wasn't good, because in their opinion, his book was better. And it may be for some people. I don't even mind that. But I know that the work that I put in can't be taken away. And I know that I'm willing to do even more work to make sure that I go to the next level. So that's my story of where the book came from, and I want to hear some questions from you all, and then maybe we'll do a little writing exercise and some good stuff like that. So you all have any questions so far?
You guys can open up your, and you guys wrote your questions down.
They also wrote reasons why they liked your book.
I'm good with that.
They wrote three reasons and a couple questions.
Okay. Do we have someone who'd like to go third? Or first, depending on.
Yeah, why don't we start with Caitlin? We'll start with your questions or your comments.
Oh, sure, take your dog first. What made you decide to write the book?
I really wanted my students to read. We were having, it was at the point of the school year where if you don't get these kids to really appreciate reading, they're not going to and they won't make progress over the year. Some of them who were stronger readers would just read. The other ones who weren't as strong were good readers but didn't like to read. We couldn't provide anything in our school library because our school library was like that corner over there. I didn't have enough books that they liked on my shelves. They didn't go to the public library. Whatever the reason was, I had to do something about it. I couldn't just sit there. So if I had to bribe them by creating something that I knew they would like, then that's what I had. At some point in time, as a teacher or as an adult, you have to step up and do what you can for the kids that are around you. And that was my way of stepping up. And it helped them with behavior, it helped them with their reading, and it also encouraged them. So they had journals a lot like this, and every day they would write in them for about a half hour. And then they would get an opportunity to share for 2 minutes, and they would tell their story and leave with it to be continued or stay tuned. Everyone in the room's like, oh, come on, can you get another? That's what we did. and it turned into an environment where reading and writing was important.
Reginald?
What made you make it funny?
I knew that you can't keep a kid's attention for 100 and some pages without any humor. And I like laughing as well. So part of me is that humor, putting it in the book. And so that's why I did it. And then I just like to laugh. And I know the mind of kids in that age group because I've been working with them for 22 years. Ever since I was 14 years old, I was working with fifth graders. So that helped me to really understand what makes them laugh, how they think, how their minds work. And then I also, as a teacher, I couldn't just make it a book where you just laugh nonstop. I have to show you some sort of lesson in order to be able to get you to go from one place to another and grow. So that's why there's that mixture. That's why they overcome certain obstacles and become better over the course of one day. But they are not fixed, so to speak. They still have a lot of progress that they need to make.
Were there anyone that had wrinkles on their forehead when they laughed?
Probably me. I think a lot of people, when they're trying to tell those stories, their eyebrows go up like, believe me, I'm honest, I'm not tough. So, and then, you know, some people have different features when they tell the stories. They look up and maybe to the left, or they look off, or they won't look you in the eye, they look down. My mom happened to know all of my little things that I gave as clues to tell when I was telling the truth or not.
Yeah. Where did you get the idea for the name Wrinkles Wallace?
I didn't want a regular name. I didn't want a Tom or a George or anything like that. I wanted something that was going to stick out, be different, and pretty positive. And so I thought Wrinkles will make people want to know why his name is Wrinkles. And then Wallace went with Wrinkles, and so I just figured it would flow like that. And it sounded strong to me.
Why did you choose to be an author?
It kind of chose me, to be honest. I knew I had the ability to write stuff. I just didn't have the confidence to do it all the time. I would write when someone would make me upset. I would write, you know, just for fun, and I would keep it to myself. But I never really wrote very much for other people. We had these things called unity circles at my school, and it's pretty much like a play that we did once a month, and we'd take something like understanding, or kindness, or any other positive virtues like that, and we would turn it into this major skit. And so what I ended up doing was writing really good skits for this that caused the rest of the building to really enjoy their morning. And then we do morning assembly every morning, and on my days, we'd have the kids do the top 10 this, you know, reasons why we should have spring break, or reasons why we need more homework. And so I was creative like that, but I didn't take it as serious as I should have. And so once I, you know, started writing the book, after writing the book, I didn't consider myself a writer. It took me going to this event called the Eastern Michigan Writing Project, and it's a thing where in the summertime, teachers go for 30 days, and we write, and we talk about writing, and how to be better writers, and how to be better teachers of writing. And that's when I discovered and accepted myself as a writer. So even after I had written that book, I still consider myself a teacher. Now I consider myself both, depending on the day, but always a writer for sure.
How did you pick all the names? Like, how did you decide?
The names, most of them are attributes of the characters. So Snooze pretty much sleeps throughout the entire book. So that's another name for sleeping. Your Highness is like a diva, and so when you pronounce it like Your Highness, even though it's spelled different, it's, you know, that queen, royalty, et cetera, et cetera. Spork cooks, and a spork is like the spoon and fork combination put together. Her name was originally Chef, but Chef is on a different, on a former cartoon that isn't out anymore, and so I didn't want to give her the same name of another character. So Spork was the first thing that came to mind after that. Having a teacher by the name of Mr. Quiet or Sit and Be Quiet definitely makes an impact on kids when they're reading the book. But once I say what his name is, when I read it out loud, you always hear giggles. And so I like his name. Lenny just has a regular old name. But Lenny actually, I had a teacher's assistant at my school, and he was an older gentleman who was ornery every day, miserable, grumpy. I mean, he just didn't want to be there. He didn't like the women drivers on 94 who made him late every day. He didn't like the kids. He didn't like the music I played. He didn't like anything. And he was just grumpy all the time. And he had like a walker and a cane, and he had a cell phone on his arm. And then he would go out and do real estate deals in the middle of my class. And so he really didn't want to be there, and it was obvious. And so a lot of the character, but he was a brilliant musician and conductor, and he was great with kids and getting them to learn the recorder and sing in the choir. I mean, he was brilliant, but he only wanted to do that, and we only needed him to do that for like an hour a day. And so he was there for the 7 hours to do that. Lenny is a lot like that guy. He was ornery, he always had a wisecrack, he was just, you know, he talked about the kids, and I'm like, you can't do that. Oh, they know they are. I'm like, you have to chill. So Lenny came from him, and anyone who knew me that year and knew that the guy worked with me could see him and say that's exactly who Lenny is. So I do use people in my life or people that I see out in public for inspiration for characters. If I had a job in the office and sometimes kids would come to my, I was what they call a behavior interventionist. So say you're misbehaving in class and the teacher can't teach you anymore, then they would send you to my office, and we would work on strategies or ways to get you back into the classroom and learn. And I would get a lot of the most wonderful stories about why a kid couldn't do this, why I hit someone, why I didn't go to the bathroom, why I needed to go to the bathroom and had an accident, all these stories. And so, you know, as I collected this stuff, I'm like, I could do things with this. Now, I can't tell exactly the story, but because I'm living and I'm out in the world and I'm experiencing things, that gives me ideas for books that I can play with and twist around and then come up with.
Awesome. Oh, why did you pick the 80s for the kids?
As far as the Mr. Quiet is 10 and the others, I wanted role reversal. And that's a really quick way to grab the attention of a kid, is by putting them in charge. Many of you all are in school. All y'all should be in school. Anyone graduate just yet? Not yet. Okay, you all are in school, and for the most part, I'm betting that there's not one of you that wouldn't believe that you could actually get up there and teach and do a good job and be in charge and make good decisions. And a lot of times, adults don't listen to kids like they should. I had to get constructive criticism from my students in order for my book to be even better. But a lot of times, you know, it's students aren't allowed to have the type of opinion that they need, or they aren't able to express themselves in a way that's respectful, where kid or the adults aren't saying, just be quiet, go somewhere and sit down. And so I wanted to give the kid the power in the book. Now, the funny thing about that is he is a 10-year-old, but he still has all the attributes, all the characteristics of what could be considered a teacher. So other than his age, he is just like a normal teacher that you might see in school. And their ages are older, but they do things that would remind you of kids. And so that the message is also that what you do as a child can lead to who you are as an adult. And if you don't change those habits, it might cause you to have some sort of strife or trouble later on in life. So that's why the ages are reversed. Plus, this is nice every now and then to let a kid be in charge. Right? Yes.
Carlicia.
No question. No comment. No,
you don't want to read one of your questions?
Carlicia.
Oh, they already asked the one she had?
You have any other questions?
Why don't you give one of the things you liked about the book?
You can ask me why I wore orange today or something like that. Officially, if we say writing this book 2006, published 2012, and like I said, the next book should be coming out within a month. I've written a total of 16 books. The second one is coming out. It just takes a lot of time for the publisher to go through read the book, edit it, find the artwork on the cover, and then put it out, make their money back, put out another book, et cetera, et cetera. So it takes a lot of time. But I like to have, I'd rather have the books written and be waiting on the publisher than have the publisher waiting on me to finish a book. Mr. Parks, when would we be able to get that book? I don't know. I don't want it to be like that. I never want them to wait on me. I'd rather wait on them and then test my patience. Yes?
How long did it take you to write
the first book right there? It took 7 months with 6 weeks of writer's block. The last big book that I finished took 25 days. I was laid off, so I didn't have a job. And I was writing during the summertime. And so I would get up early in the morning and get my son on the bus. And then from probably 12 to 4, I would write. And everyone would come home at 4. And then from 10 to 2 o'clock in the morning, I would write some more. So that's how I was able to finish the book in 25 days. I probably could have done it in 18, but I took some days off. I was watching ESPN a little too much. I hung out with my family, stuff like that. So at this point, I could probably write a book in 3 weeks. The picture books that I write, they take about an hour. I think about it a lot, though. I don't just sit down and say, what should I write about? When I'm in the car, I'm thinking about writing. When I'm sitting on the couch, I'm thinking about writing. When I'm on YouTube, I'm thinking about writing. When I always think about it. So when I do have a chance to sit down, I'm not saying, what should I write about? I'm actually throwing out all the stuff that I've been thinking about. So that's my pre-writing process.
Nevin? You have a question? I know he wasn't here, so he didn't read the book.
Yeah, I just gave him a question. He's too shy. What's the name of your new book?
The next book is called Wrinkles Wallace, Fighters of Foreclosure. When I first started thinking about titles and what I could write about, foreclosure was huge in Michigan and around the country. If you all aren't aware of what foreclosure is, it's when you have a house and for some reason you aren't able to pay the mortgage on the house, and the bank will take the house back from you. And so you have to find a new place to stay. And that was really prevalent, or it was something that was going on a lot when I first started thinking about books to write. So in this book, one of the characters is about to lose his home. The family will have to move on Monday, and it's Friday. So he wants to have some sort of sleepover and raise money through contests, where they really con people out of their money in order to be able to save this house by Monday morning, and they need to raise $22,000 between Friday and Monday morning in order to save the house. So the band gets back together, so to speak. You'll see Wrinkles and Your Highness and Spork, everybody's back doing their thing.
Does anyone have another question they want to ask or something else? Go ahead, Asha.
Go ahead.
What kind of
what?
College.
College did I go to? I started out. Y'all want the real story? The camera's on and all that? Okay.
It's good for them to hear the real story.
All right. Now, here's the deal. I started out at Eastern Michigan University doing undergrad work, wanting to be a teacher. I didn't go to class enough. I didn't do enough homework. I didn't do what I needed to do to be a good student. And so I was on what's called academic probation. Academic probation means if you don't do good next semester, you're getting kicked out. And so I get on academic probation. I do well the next semester. Take the summer off, I come back to school, I get on academic probation again, I almost get kicked out of school, and then I get myself together and be okay. So I almost got kicked out of school twice for not taking care of my business. I left Eastern Michigan and went out to the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, which is in Las Vegas, obviously, and I did really well there. I accepted myself as a student. I went to class every day to the point where I didn't even have to study anymore because I remembered every single thing that went on. I'd type up my notes, look over them for maybe 10, 15 minutes before the test, and then I would go and just knock the test out and get an A. So I ended up making the dean's list, getting scholarships. I totally turned my academic ability around. I went from a low C student to an A student. But it was a decision that I made. There were people that influenced me. And I decided I didn't want to be smart and not show anyone that I was smart anymore. I could just do the work, prove it to them, and then there was no question about it. And so that's when I ended up finishing at UNLV. Great experience for me. I am a running rubber, and it shows. And then I went to Eastern. I did my master's degree at Eastern. The program is anywhere from 2.5 years to 3 years. I did it in 18 months, which is a year and a half. And I was a zombie. I was taking three classes a semester. I was a full-time parent and all that good stuff, husband, and then I was working. So I slept probably 3 to 5 hours a night. If I wasn't in class or writing or sleeping with my son and my wife, I was the toughest 18 months of my life by far, but I needed to get it finished. So I woke up and I was a zombie. I probably didn't get out of that mode for a year after. So
go Hurons.
Hmm?
I said go Hurons.
Yep. I even used my book as part of my culminating project to get my master's. There were four people on my panel. Two of them loved my book and thought it was art and that it could go places. Two of them hated my book. They didn't like it. They didn't think it was good for kids. They thought it was violent because of the food fight and the dodgeball game. They thought it was, they thought it catered to men and boys because of the fact that, what was it? That one of the, that Mr. Quiet's mom was going to make fish sticks for him, and they thought that I wasn't reinforcing that mom's cooking the house when it could be others, or that Spork had to cook for Mr. Quiet. They thought that that was me forcing women to do things for men. And I'm like, no, that's not it. So not everyone that I encountered who had power over me or who had some sort of say in how well I did liked my book. I had to go on and do that. I ended up writing an entirely new version of the book. It was 2.0. It took out all of that stuff, and they wouldn't even read it. They were like, oh, well, you did it? Okay, well, that's fine. So, you know, certain things that we go through, it's not always going to work in your favor and be easy. There will be obstacles in the way, be it, you know, life and time, people. Even sometimes we create obstacles for ourselves. But you have to persevere, you have to get through it, you have to keep trying.